All right, let's convene. Thank you, everybody, for being here. For those of you who I don't know or who are online, I'm Sandro Galea. I have the great privilege of serving as Dean of the School of Public Health here. And this is our monthly public health forum, which is our premier academic talk of the calendar for the school. And today we're extraordinarily fortunate to have with us a Professor Eldar Shafir. And for many of you who are part of our school community, you know that we care tremendously about issues of income, economics, and the political, economic, and structural forces that produce the health of populations. And Professor Shafir is one of the giants in the field who has written, as far as I'm concerned, some of the really seminal work that helps shape our thinking on this. Let me tell you a little bit about his formal biography. He serves as the William Stewart Todd Professor of Psychology and Public Affairs at Princeton University. He is also the director of Princeton's Center for Behavioral Science and Public Policy, co-founder and director of Ideas 42, which is a social science R&D lab. So that means he only wears three hats, which means he's got a lot more time left. He studies decision-making in behavioral economics and has written quite a bit on decision-making in context of poverty and applying behavioral research in policy. He has received a number of awards, which I will actually not go into all of them, but recently he also received a Guggenheim Fellowship and a William James Book Award. He was named one of Foreign Policy Magazine's 100 Leading Global Thinkers, and his most recent books are The Behavioral Foundations of Public Policy and Scarcity, Why Having Too Little Means So Much. I had never had the pleasure of meeting Professor Shafir, and one of the real joys of being a dean of a school of public health is being able to invite people to speak who you've admired for a long time. And I've actually admired him quite a bit since, particularly since reading Scarcity, which I think is a terrific book and also an extraordinarily good read. Eldar.
Thank you. Am I on? It's a great pleasure. I was telling colleagues before, I haven't spent much time in public health schools, and I've had a delightful day and some remarkable conversations, so thank you. What I'm going to do, I brought a lot of slides. We'll see how many I get through. I'm a behavioral researcher. I'm a behavioral scientist. I'm going to come at the problem of scarcity and living with not enough from a behavioral lens. And so what I like to do when I do that is to spend a couple of minutes giving you kind of the perspective that I come from. So I call it Psych 101 Express, very quickly. Give you a sense from where I'm coming from, then talk about how I think this sheds light on issues of scarcity, and then maybe talk a bit about policy implications and have a discussion. When you do behavioral research, it's very hard not to start with a series of studies that happened in the 60s and 70s that really changed social psychology and social science forever, as far as I'm concerned. These are mostly European psychologists who came from Europe, sort of obsessed with what made the German mind the mind that it was, that let the things happen that happened. Of course, we know now there's nothing German about it. All of us carry that mind behind the eyes and between the ears. But this was really a dramatic event. And so I'll give you some of these studies have entered popular culture. You might recognize some of them. I want to give you my two-minute perspective on them. So this one, for example, this is Stanley Milgram, who runs a study at the basement of the Yale psych department. He gets middle-aged men to participate. They think they're being assigned randomly to student or teacher, but all of them will be a teacher right there, being introduced by the experimenter to a student. The student sitting down attached to electrodes is a confederate, is an actor. He's working with the experimenter. And after you get introduced, the subject goes to the other side, to a different room. And he's a different side of the partition. He administers, these are paired associates, it doesn't really matter, but you teach the student house banana. Later when the teacher says house, the student is supposed to say banana. If he gets it right, bravo, we move on. If he gets it wrong, he gets a slight electric shock. And as this proceeds, it's very carefully choreographed. The shock, every time you give one, the lever stays down. You go progressively higher in the shocks as the student continues to make mistakes. Again, very carefully choreographed. Up to a certain point of the voltage, the actor grunts. Then at some point, he screams. At 150, he screams, get me out of here. I told you I have heart trouble, which he happens to mention when they first meet. All this, by the way, there is actual archives. You can see it on PBS. At 270, there's screams of agony. If you were to choose to go that high, that's the plan. If you were to go to 330, I don't know if you see here, but it gets progressively worse. If you go to 3:30 and you say house, nothing at all comes back. After the guy told you it's heart trouble and all that, there's total silence. 3:40, 3:50, 3:60, 3:70, up to 4:50 if you chose to do this, there'll be no answers coming, total silence from the other side. Why would anybody do this? The experimenter, who looks very distinguished and very sure of himself, being paid by Yale and wearing a white coat, says, please continue, it's imperative the experiment continue, etc. This is the setup. Milgram, who was a brilliant man, had another insight, which was to ask people to predict. He gave people a full rendition of the study in great detail and asked them to predict what will people do. And so we have the data. We know that everyone predicts disobedience at an average of 135. That's when the grunt gets slightly louder. No one predicts that anybody will go above 300, except for the psychiatrists, the professionals in the northeast of the US in the 70s, who recognize that 1 in 1,000 will be a sociopath who might go up to 450. So that's what we know people knew. What Milgram finds is that 65% are sociopaths and that everybody goes above 300. Now, we can spend a semester on this. Milgram is blown away. I mean, there's correspondence between him and the NIH who's funding this. He plans to show that America, the land of the independent American spirit, looks different from other things he saw. It's not happening. He then replicates this in Bennington College, which is the bastion of leftist liberalism in the 70s. They look worse than Yale. You can't get rid of it. And this is, again, it's a true discovery about human behavior. We know for a fact that nobody knew this. And we know for a fact that even now that we know it, and I tell you this, most of us suspect that we would not be among those doing this kind of thing, and most of us are profoundly wrong. It's very hard to incorporate into our perspective of who we are and how we work and how we behave. And this, along with others, have become sort of the staple of modern social psych. So when you teach social psych, the number one task you have is to try to arrange, to come to the point where when somebody who took your course opens the paper and reads about Abu Ghraib, they say to themselves, these are not terrible people, they're totally average people who we put in a terrible situation. Very hard to do, but that's kind of the agenda. So the number one insight from behavioral research that's relevant to us is how powerful the situation is and how we tend not to get it. And I'll give you a few examples, but the point here is that you don't have to be electrocuting people. This is true about how supermarket shelves are designed. It's true about how classrooms are arranged. Anything you do, the context has enormous power that we fail to appreciate, and with enormous consequences. It, of course, the end of the story is going to be that people in this room, this is very important because context is something that some of you can design or can alter or can manipulate in ways that can have a big impact if we know how to do it. There is another nuance. It's a little bit more academic, but I like to point it out because I think it's important, and that's what social psychology calls construal. When you give people a choice between two options, job A and job B, people are not choosing between job A and job B. They're choosing between job A and job B as they are represented in the strange machine that we carry with us in the brain. And that's a super important point. All of behavioral economics, in some sense, if you look at all the work on framing, the idea is I give you the same option described in slightly two different ways, and you construe it differently. And so if you think about economic modeling, for example, there's a remarkably courageous assumption that people are choosing between things as they are in the world, not between things as they are perceived by us. And that's an enormous problem. So that's construal. again, it's important because you shape how people see things. It's true everywhere. Construal makes a big difference to how you construe surveys, how you design architectural constructions, et cetera. It should be obvious, so here is one example. This is, I hope you're seeing it well enough. If you see this well enough, this is a visual illusion. If I ask you, forget 3D cues. If just in two dimensions on the screen, how do these cars compare? If this is working, you will be reluctant to believe me that these are exactly the same size. Okay, so this car on the screen is exactly the same size as this one. Okay, and now it's hard to convince you. What I can try to do is take a line segment, simply cut and paste it three times, here it is, to try to prove it to you. Beautiful studies in perception have shown that if I put you in the right situation and do this, you are so intent on believing that the top car is bigger than the bottom, you actually see the line segments stretch and condense as they move, because you're unwilling to give up the belief that these are not the same. I'm showing you this only to say, here is an obvious case where the world is not as you perceive it. there is something going on. What our experience is obviously not one-to-one to the world, and this is going to be true about experiments in the basements of Yale's psych department. It's going to be true about jobs that we get offered. It's going to be true about medications that somebody gives us. In every case, you perceive it somehow, and then it has an enormous influence on what happens. In general, the idea that mental life makes a difference gets complicated very quickly. Don't worry about all the numbers here. It's just to tell you a very simple fact. Imagine you ask yourself, is it worth to invest more to commute every day in a BMW rather than a Ford Escort? Perfectly reasonable question. So let's look at the data. What does the data say? The first three lines, basically, you call people in different conditions. It doesn't matter now exactly. Students, faculty, before, after. You ask them, what car are you driving? And how is the commute today? And what you discover is a BMW is more fun than an Escort. Now you do it again, and you say, well, how is the commute today? And by the way, what car are you driving? And there is no difference at all. If people think about the car they're driving, they report that BMWs are more fun. If they're thinking about anything else in the world, no difference in the pleasure they're getting from the commute. Now, notice, if you're a BMW, one thing you want to do is put a little thing that every 15 seconds says you're driving a BMW, because that would remind them. But notice, beyond that, it's kind of a deep question. Depending on people are, how they're construing the drive, it may or may not make a difference to driving a better car. Okay? So these contextual effects are powerful. And very quickly, when you look at behavioral work as it applies to policy, another issue intrudes, which is what we call the intention-action tension. Context leads us to do things in a certain way, often not according to the intentions that we had in advance. So people teach us to eat healthy, exercise enough, get enough sleep, and we might form those intentions, and there's context. And that's a big issue. So this is the kind of picture that should be memorable for you. No need to explain. And so here are people who understand, intend to play 45 minutes on the Stairmaster. You put the escalator, they're on it. What do you do with that? That's kind of the behaviorally interesting question. If you're Korea, you do this. But in the US, that's not so easy to do. We have to be a little bit more subtle. So the question is, what do you do in the US to induce the right behaviors, at least among those who have the right intention? That's really the question. Now, there are many examples where we've done things badly. Not necessarily intentionally, of course, but that's just how things evolve. If you look, for example, at competition between restaurants in the US, that's what you get. Don't forget, you have to do pi r squared. So in fact, it's you're eating twice as much. And this is a big issue because I know I ought to eat a certain amount. We sit down for dinner. The conversation is wonderful. I don't pay attention. I'm mindlessly eating. There's a lot of work in mindless eating. Not to mention that my grandma told me I have to finish everything that's on the plate. And next you know, this is a striking one. I don't know if you've all seen this, but this basically says when you go downtown and order a burger today, what you get on your plate is exactly three burgers that your grandma used to get on her plate. So, and this is a context where, in some sense, people's intentions don't even matter because you get the plate, you eat it, and you will have eaten three lunches of your grandma's every time you have a lunch. This becomes even more complicated or relevant. This is a slide just that reminds me to tell you about financial literacy. So there's a lot of money spent in the US on financial literacy. Of course, who do we teach financial literacy? We teach those who don't look so good, namely the poor. So we teach them financial literacy. And imagine if I taught you swimming 101, beginner swimming, and then I tossed you into a massively stormy sea. You'd drown. Of course, I could toss you into a small, very calm Geneva lake. What you find when you do financial literacy, there's been a recent meta-analysis of over 100 interventions, is that people who get financial literacy training answer questions better on the test, and there is no impact whatsoever on their lives. Basically, you teach people financial literacy, and then you toss them into massively stormy, unregulated American market, and they drown. People sell them ballooning mortgages and payday loans and all kinds of other stuff. But then comes an interesting question. If I take you, the busy American poor, and teach you financial literacy, which then has no impact on your life, am I doing you a favor? Shouldn't you be spending your time elsewhere? And this becomes a complicated issue because I'm not an expert, but certainly there are going to be cases where you will have seen people getting lectures about medical adherence. And if context makes it hard to do, I got it. I know I should adhere to my medication. Thank you very much. I'm failing for other reasons than needing another lecture again from you. And those are issues that are often, you know, exactly the tension between intention and action. And then there are cases where you can do things better. The single most generous benefit program in the US today, many people in this room may have been beneficiaries, is FAFSA, which is school money to go to college. It's an extreme, not to mention lifetime earnings, but it's an extremely generous program. Uptake is about a third of eligibles. So it's very low. You're getting a fantastic gift that has lifetime income, and a third of eligibles take it. This is the form. It's a form where, you know, one of the pages reminds you that you're answering under the penalty of perjury. You know, there's many reasons to look at this form and notice you're not saying, I hereby declare I won't get FAFSA. You're just saying, thank you, that's great. Look at this form. You put it on a shelf and you wait for your sister to come back from medical school to help you. And life goes by. Okay, this is a classic behaviorally relevant obstacle because it could be changed somehow. People have tried this. Philoreopoulos in Canada has done a couple of studies. So the purple is the application and matriculation as it stands. The second, the green, is I come to you and I say, I know everything about you. I know your household income, your parents' income. You're eligible for FAFSA. Here is the form. Okay, so we know now, you know for sure. There's no informational issues anymore. The effect, nothing. Same as before. Next condition, I know everything about you. I know you're entitled to FAFSA. I know your income. Here is the form. Let's fill it out together. And actual matriculation goes up 25%. So once you have this form, you have a person who has the intention, all you need is a minimum income person to sit with them and help them fill out the form, and there's a lifetime difference, which is cheaper than other things we've tried. Okay, it's the point that you have to find the obstacle. What is it that's stopping people? Do they not want FAFSA? Do they not want higher education? Or is there a stupid form that somehow we can overcome with some intelligent intervention? A lot of beautiful work on retirement savings by David Lapson and his colleagues at Harvard, where you basically come to work at a firm. We say to you, welcome. Here is your package. You get 2% retirement savings defaulted into, 2% of your income defaulted into your retirement savings. Here's a phone number. Feel free to call anytime you want and change the amount. Others who come to the firm on other randomized weeks, welcome, same thing. You get defaulted into 5% retirement savings. Here's a phone number. Feel free to call anytime. Transaction cost is just a phone call. They're open 24/7. It's one of the most important financial decisions you'll ever make. And what this shows is that people who work in the same firm 4 years later, those who happen to be defaulted into higher savings are going to retire much richer than those who have been defaulted into lower savings, which says that now you have to take this very, very seriously. Standard economic thinking says, I have a percentage that I want to put aside. Transaction cost is minimal. Leave it to the good American to do. Bush wanted people to manage their retirement savings on their own completely. And this says, no, all that constant, you just switch the default, you switch something, and it makes a big difference to people's lives. My biggest victory in recent years at Princeton was that we have a policy that women, well, both, but mostly women who have children are entitled to a year of teaching relief. And it turned out that in the sciences, like if you're a young physicist, the uptake wasn't very high. And there was a theory that somehow if you're a young woman in physics, you're worried that the old guys will think you're not serious if you apply for a year leave. So the university switched it after we talked to them. And now when you have a child, you have a leave and you can apply to renounce it. And nobody does and nobody resents them for it. And you can see the difference between you're looking for it as opposed to you're trying to get rid of it. That had a big difference on the number of women who have relief from teaching, exactly along these lines. This is probably my favorite. I guess some people here must know this well, but this is a glow cap. It's a little capsule that costs $15 and complains if you fail to open it in time to take your medication. And by complains, I mean it lights up, it screeches, it calls you on your cell phone and sends you an email. And there is some argument that if you're HIV positive and you have access to the medication, of course, but life interferes and you're distracted, this can make a big difference. So this is the behavioral world in which I work. Small contexts make a big difference. People can act better or worse as a function of small nuances. And then we look at the world of the poor. When Sendel and I, my colleague and I, started looking at the poverty stuff, what's very clear is that the poor behave badly almost anywhere you look. If you look at medical adherence, people have problems. The poor are worse culprits than the rich. If you move to the fields of India, where weeding your field is a very effective way to increase your income, poor farmers weed their fields less than the richer farmer next to them. Parenting, Barnes & Noble is full of books about parenting and how the poor are inconsistent and are paying less attention. Finance, it's almost infinite. If I have time, I'll talk a bit about payday loans. But the poor do things badly. And the question is, how to explain all that. This is just to say there's a lot of work that's been done, and I do not for one second mean to replace it. There's no doubt that geography, place, education, peer effects, neighborhood effects, all those are gonna be play a role in what we see among the poor. What I'm gonna do here is look at another issue, which is just basically the psychology that emerges in context of poverty and what it does to behavior. Because that's the agenda for today. So in the book that we wrote with a number of wonderful colleagues, the story is gonna be really quite simple. The story is gonna be that the context of poverty is a very powerful, demanding context. When you don't have enough, I'll focus mostly on money, but I'll mention it doesn't have to be, you spend a lot of your cognitive resources on managing this thing you don't have enough of. And when you do that, working very hard, focusing on what you don't have enough of, the periphery loses attention. You spend less time attending to other things. And when you have the psychology in the context of poverty, bad things happen. That's gonna be the argument. It starts with the idea that people spend a lot of time focusing on managing, juggling their poverty. And in fact, if you look out there in the world, there's a lot of data that suggests that's the case. A lot of work in marketing, for example, finds that if you stand outside of the supermarket and ask people how much did you pay for the pasta, how much did you pay for the sauce, the poor are much more likely to know the answer than the rich. That's what they're attending to. They think about trade-offs a lot more often than rich people do. It's kind of interesting. Think about this. In economics, everything you pay, anything you give up, it's a trade-off. You'll never have it again. But many people in this room, when you go have a dinner or a lunch or buy a book or buy a CD or have a cup of coffee, you don't ask yourself, what will I not buy instead? It's as if you're reaching into an infinite bucket of small expenses. The person who sells you the coffee often asks herself, if I have a coffee or a lunch with a friend, what will I not buy instead? Trade-off thinking is much more frequent. You do this all the time. This is a really fun one. We did it actually here at South Station. When people came out of the station, we asked them for the household income. And then we asked them, when you go into a cab in Boston, what does the meter read initially? And it's fun because clearly the rich take taxis much more often than the poor, but the poor are much more likely to know the answer. And so what I want to leave you here is a metaphorical thought that when the rich enter the cab, we enjoy the Charles River. When the poor enter, they're looking at the meter. And that's where the mind is. That's how you're juggling poverty. You're looking at the prices, you're looking at the meter, you're thinking trade-offs. You're basically what we call tunneling. You're thinking of what's urgent right now, and things that might be important, you recognize are important in the periphery, you're much less likely to attend to. Okay, the metaphor I use these days to capture it is imagine you're driving in the middle of a very severe storm. You focus on the 3 feet ahead of you. You're not gonna notice the billboard signs. You're not gonna notice other things that are happening in the periphery. That's what you're focusing on. You're seeing it as good as anybody ever will. You're really looking carefully, but the rest loses attention. And when that happens, when you're focused very carefully, we have very limited bandwidth. We have very limited capacity, much more limited than we appreciate. So if you look at works that's been done now on simulators and cars, if you give somebody a cell phone to talk in the car, no hands held, just talking on the phone in the car, your reaction time in a simulator and your ability to detect the periphery compared to somebody who's legally drunk. You give a lot up in your cognitive capacity and your bandwidth when you're on the phone. I was telling students earlier today, very amusing studies. If I took this half of the room and asked you to remember two digits, just remember 1-7 for me. And this half I asked, please remember seven digits, 1-7-2-4-6-4-5. If you kept these seven digits and these two, what you find is that the next half hour while you're doing this, this half would eat less healthy, would just be monitoring their surroundings less well. Literally, there's a study where they put a guy dressed as a clown on a unicycle, and you'd be less likely to notice it than these guys. And so the point is that the poor, or others who manage scarcity, are walking around with seven digits in their head. They're juggling this thing they don't have enough of, these concerns, these limitations, and that's gonna impact other things they can do. We describe a very touching study, this is in Connecticut in a classroom, where kids are assigned randomly into one of two classrooms. One class is in the quiet side of the school, the other class is near the train tracks. They have a train outside the window occasionally. Are the trains distracting? Sure, they're distracting. How distracting are they? What these guys find is that in fifth grade, the kids near the train track are 1 year behind in academic performance. That's an enormous effect. They install soundproofing, the kids catch up, et cetera. And my point to you again, to a thought to retain, imagine you're sitting down in a perfectly quiet room, no trains. you're trying to do something, and a worry about food for your kids on Friday comes up, you're going to be able to focus less well. These are internal trains. And so in some sense, what's happening is that those who have concerns that are weighing on them and can't let go have these internal trains that are very similar to having trains outside the window. Okay. In the book, I'm not going to do this much now, but in the book, we discuss the fact that scarcity doesn't have to be about money. It could be about food. It could be about time. Many people in this room, in some really interesting ways, are time poor in ways that are very similar to the way that our subjects are money poor. I have a very good friend who works very hard. He paints houses. He's done it five. I ask him, do you want to go to the movies? He says, what's the movie? If I asked most people in this room, do you want to go to the movie? What's the movie and what do I not do tonight that I meant to do tonight that I'm going to have to do tomorrow? You're doing trade-off thinking. Temptations are interesting. I'm not going into them. But basically, here is one thought. As you succeed in America, spending time with your kids has become a temptation you need to resist because you're busy, which is kind of remarkable because that should be something that is available to anybody who's managed a reasonably acceptable life. Same thing for the poor, where a sandwich or lunch with a friend has become a luxury that a temptation needs to be resisted. I love this one because there's a lot of critique that the poor have all kinds of debt they can't cover, and yet they go and buy a donut. And my question to you is, how many of you in this room have commitments on time that you know you'll not be able to respect? And if so, what are you doing here schmoozing with me? You should be doing a few more minutes of work. Very similar logic. And generally, most importantly, every mistake you make, forgetting to pay the parking meter, getting stuck in traffic, when you don't have enough money or time, you pay a much higher price than when you're rich or have plenty of time that day. And so that obviously is an important thing. One more footnote, by the way. When you do work on poverty, a very common question in the US is, what are you talking about the American poor? All of them, you know, have TVs, and if you put them in India, they'd be middle class. So I just want to get rid of this. I understand where it comes from, but I think it's profoundly misguided. So you get these kinds of things. 91% of the poor have whatever it is. Color. I love the color TVs, as if you can buy black and white if you wanted to, but fine, they have color TVs. So this comes all the time, and what's interesting is every time they do this, it's reported massively without any commentary. The last one was in 2011. Again, they all have air conditioning and cable TVs. What do we learn from this? The only people I found commenting this, kind of the deep observers of the American scene, one was Colbert, who said, this proves that people, the poor are just not living down to our expectations. If you still have the strength to brush the flies off your eyeballs, you're not really poor. This is Colbert's vulgar way of saying exactly what the Heritage Foundation means to say. John Stewart said, I never realized the poor had it so good. No wonder the middle class is pouring into their ranks in droves. What's so beautiful about this is that Adam Smith, 350 years earlier, solved this completely. And it's very simple. It used to be the case you were not expected to wear a linen shirt to go to work, Adam Smith says about the British industry. Now that you are expected to wear one, if you can't afford it, you're poor. And so when I talk about the poor, all I mean by that is not at risk of starvation to death, although, of course, that's extreme poverty, but simply not being able to live the minimally acceptable life in the time and place in which you live. So yes, running water was a magnificent luxury 400 years ago. Now, if you don't have running water, you're poor. And it's a very simple definition. I don't see much problems with it. And it's a profoundly behavioral one because, of course, it will change from place to place. But we can talk more about that. Okay, scarcity as a source of demand on cognitive capacity. We tell a beautiful story about people who are starving. I'm not going to get into it here because I don't want to spend the time. But there's a magnificent book on Ansel Keys' research on starvation. They were planning, basically, as they were preparing to inherit people in the camps in Europe at the end of the Second World War, they realized they're going to have find people who are starving, and you have to know how to feed them. They didn't know how to feed them, so they hired Ansel Keys, a champion nutritionist in Minnesota, to study how to feed the starving. In order to do that, he had to starve people, so he got a group of conscientious objectors whom he starved, not to death, but to massive discomfort. Anyway, the point is that these guys are physically debilitated. They can't hold their arms above their heads long enough to wash their hair, but all they can think about is food. It's kind of tragicomic. They memorize recipes. They plan to open restaurants. You know, notice they have no food. They should be trying to think about sports. But all they think about is food. They compare prices. At some point, the researchers feel so bad, they show them a movie. And the testimonials are, these guys showed me a movie. I couldn't care less about the love scenes. I wanted to see the meals. That's all they can think about. And so what you get when under scarcity is that your mind is just goes to the thing you don't have enough of. Very powerfully. This is a study that was done not by us, but another group of wonderful researchers. Subjects are asked not to drink for 4 hours, so they all come to the lab thirsty. Half of them, by random assignment, get water. The other half get pretzels. Not a good idea when you're thirsty. And now we sit there, and I give you words, and it's a classical decision task. You have to decide, is this a word in the English language or not? And what you find is that those who just had the pretzels are significantly faster in responding to thirst-related words compared to control words where they're the same. So you're literally, these are 400 millisecond responses. You're literally showing that the thirsty walk around with thirst-related words activated in their semantic networks. That's what's activated right now. It takes less time to trigger it. And when you activate some concepts, others get interfered with. They lose. This is a study we did with dieters in California. So the subjects here, half of them are dieting and half of them are not. And it's a classic word search task. You have to find the words here. And it comes in two conditions. What you'll see is here the odd number words are diet-related, cake, donut, sweet, etc. Here these words have been replaced with non-diet-related words. So instead of cake, you have street and so forth. The even number words are identical. What we're going to do now is look at how long it takes you to find the even number words, the ones that are the same in both, as a function of the other words in the context. And all this will become clearer very quickly. The non-dieters show no effect. The dieters take significantly longer to find the word cloud when it's preceded by a donut than when it's preceded by a picture. Once you're a dieter and saw donut, it just takes you longer to do the next thing. It's literally interfering. And they've done beautiful work on people who have worries about retirement. This is a classic Stroop test. Your task, and there's many words, I'm just giving you one example. What color is the word written in? That's your task. So the answer here is red and here it's blue. What they show is if you take people who have concerns about retirement and a control group, both groups say blue equally quickly, but those who have concerns about retirement take significantly longer, twice as long, to say red compared to those who do not have retirement concerns. Once you see it, you cannot say red, you think about retirement. Okay, so these are all cases where a concern basically interferes with your function, which led us to a number of studies. I'll give you a couple here. This is a New Jersey Mall study. We asked people to participate in a study. They agree. We put them in front of a computer. We pay them to participate. We're going to give you scenarios that come from everyday life, like your car breaks down, it's going to cost X dollars to fix. While you're thinking how you're going to take care of this problem, just to make it more interesting, we'll let you play some games. The games we'll let them play, which is sort of fun, are classic cognitive psych tests. This is a Raven's matrices. All of you have done this before. It's the most standard component of the fluid intelligence test of the IQ. It's done by all schools, ETS, jobs, etc. And this is a cognitive control test. It's a divided attention. You have to respond as quickly as you can. Same side as if it's a flower, opposite side if it's a heart. It's kind of a cognitive control divided attention test. So they get these scenarios, they play these games, and then they're going to tell us what they're going to do. The scenarios come in two versions. The manageable version, the car is going to cost you $150 to fix, which we know for most people in the mall is manageable. The challenging version, the car is going to cost you $1,500 to fix, which we know for half of people in the mall is a massive challenge. So you get one or the other, you play the games, and then you answer. And then we're going to look at how you do in these cognitive tests. Here it is. When you look at the divided attention, the cognitive tool, like a driving test, the rich don't care which car they're fixing. They do equally well whether they're worried about the $1,500 or the $150 car. And by the way, we divide the respondents by household income, by median split, into rich and poor, which conforms pretty much to low income in the US. The poor, when they're thinking about the manageable $150 car, do exactly as well as their rich friends. But when they're worried about the $1,500 car, they drive less well. They lose divided cognitive control. If we move to the IQ, the rich don't care which car they're fixing. The poor are statistically identical to the rich when it comes to the manageable car, but they lose a lot when they're worried about the challenging car. This effect, the Cohen's D of 0.9, if you make certain assumptions about the IQ test distribution, they're basically losing 13 to 14 IQ points. 13 to 14 IQ points where my kids go to school is enough to take you from average to borderline gifted or from average to borderline deficient. It's a big effect. We know from other studies that if I kept you up all night, literally, you know, with Led Zeppelin blasting in the background, you would be 9 IQ points less talented today. Think about that feels. And these people who a minute ago were just as good as their friends are now feeling worse than that. It's a massive source of distraction. This is a between subject design. We looked at American poor and rich, so you could argue we've controlled for everything but maybe education, health, something. So the dream was kind of do this within subjects. We ended up running a study with sugarcane farmers in India. Sugarcane farming has harvest once a year. These are people for whom at least 65% of their yearly income comes in one day after harvest. So we run the same guys in the fields with handheld devices, but tests very similar to the ones you saw, 2 months before or after harvest, during scarcity or during plenty. And if you look at reaction times and response rates, they're about 9 IQ points less capable during scarcity than during plenty. Same person, same education, same health and everything. Almost everything. We can't control for sleep and some other things. Anyway, that's just to say, what you're getting here is a picture where scarcity is highly demanding of your attention and your resources, both intentionally and automatically, both slow and fast. It focuses you, and it's not about the poor, it's about being in context of poverty. The most satisfying study I've ever run was with Princeton undergraduates. Whatever you think about them, they are not good candidates for myopic, less, you know, no self-control, no planning. And it goes like this. They play this game, a family feud which they love to play. Some of them get more time, some of them get less. Some are rich, some are poor. And it comes in two conditions. In one condition, you cannot borrow. Every time you run out of time, you go to the next round. In the other case, you can borrow. If you run out of time and you want a few more seconds, there's a bucket of extra time you can borrow from at predatory lending rates. Every second you take costs you 2 seconds from the amount of time you have. Why do I do this? Because I mentioned to you payday loans. Payday loans are a disaster in the streets of America today. I don't know how much you know about this, but payday loans, you have to be working to get a payday loan. If they have a payday, you need $200 to finish the month. You go and get a payday loan from somebody for $200. You owe them $250 the next month. If you compute the APR, the annual rate, it's somewhere between 400 and 1,000%. If you didn't have $200, how are you going to have $250 next month? Typically, the only way to do it, unless you win the lottery, is to take a payday loan. So the finding is that people who take payday loans average between 12 and 15 a year. Recent research I saw finds that if you take the average payday loan given in America today, 70% of it goes to pay the previous one. You've just turned people into money pumps. It's a total disaster. In many places, in about 20 states, it's completely unregulated. And the question is, why would anybody do this? And the standard answer is the poor are myopic. They're not thinking ahead. They're not making plans. They're just focusing on the moment. Hence this. And what these Princeton students do is, this is how many points they get when they're rich or they're poor. So those who have more time get more points. Obvious, not surprising. That's when they cannot borrow. Now let's let them borrow. Now we're going to give this fancy Princeton undergraduates a chance to take a payday loan. And what you see is when they're rich, nothing happens. They rarely borrow and it makes no difference. When they're aching for time, and you give them these extra seconds that they can use to maybe get their answers right, which they're so excited about, they leave the lab with a lot less money. So basically, these students who a minute ago were sophisticated enough not to take a payday loan, now that they're running out of time and need it badly, take a payday loan. Okay, so that's one way of saying it's not the poor who take payday loans, it's people in scarcity who pay payday loans. Take any of us, put us there, we'll take payday loans. Okay, and that's not the way the regulatory bodies typically think about it. Really nice, interesting work on air traffic controllers who have easy and difficult days randomly assigned. Basically, what the research finds is that the air traffic controllers are less attentive parents and less attentive spouses on difficult as opposed to easy days. When you make them poor in time, they look like the poor, and make them rich that time, and they look like the rich. It's nothing about the person, it's the day they had. All this has a lot of interesting policy implications. We can talk about some of them. The scarcity the person lives through is not just a function of their income. It's a function of the income and the difficulty or ease of managing, juggling everyday life. If you make things easier, automatic deposits, automatic payments, reliable transportation, my juggling becomes easier. My scarcity mindset becomes lighter than when things are difficult. And there's many ways in which contexts can make this easier or difficult. One example that I really like, because clearly it was not the intention, if you think about Clinton's welfare lifetime five-year limits, it's a good example again because clearly Clinton and his gang didn't mean it this way. But look, imagine if I say to you, this is a beautiful day. Please send me a paragraph about your thoughts about this lecture in 5 years. What do you do? 4 years, 11 months, 3 weeks, and 5 days you do nothing. And then, okay, this jerk wanted a paragraph. You take the American poor and you tell them in 5 years there is a threat. They have a problem tomorrow. They have a problem tonight. They have a problem the next day. They're tunneling on the urgent stuff now. This five-year threat you've arranged something that penalizes them but completely fails to motivate. It's totally outside their tunnel until they wake up one day and realize they have a month left. Okay, and that's a nice example because it's not the intention, but it's a poorly designed system if you think about it this way. In general, if you think about giving people information, same thing. Sometimes my head is busy, sometimes less. Some people have more in their minds and are juggling more than others. How do I convince you? There's a lot of really interesting work on how you influence people. And to make it simpler, there's two ways. I can get you through a central processor. I need you to stop doing everything else you're doing and attend to my complicated argument and weigh the premises and the conclusions. You have to pay attention. Alternatively, you're busy doing things and I just put, you know, a Coca-Cola poster on the wall. I don't need your attention. You just leave the room at some point and you have an urge for a Coke. That's when I get to you peripherally. When do you get to things, to people centrally, and when do you get people peripherally? Think about trying to convince you to save for retirement. What poster do I put on the wall that gives you the urge to save for retirement? Nobody has found one. If you look at ads for saving for retirement, this is what they look like. Saving for retirement requires of you to stop everything and get a mini master's degree in saving for retirement. Now imagine, contrast this with trying to convince you to smoke. I don't want you to pay attention. You have too many arguments for why it's stupid. I need you to be busy doing other things, and while your life is busy, I'm going to flash pictures of, you know, beautiful people, Italian villas. This is America, so a gun or two can be a good thing. And next you know, I give you the urge to smoke. And this is a deep issue because if you're cognitively loaded, some things will reach you and others will not. And that's all to say, if you look at all this together, what's so remarkable is that functioning under scarcity requires so much more of you. And instead of respect, you get disrespected. And instead of help, you get obstacles. And we can spend a lot of time talking about this, but a lot of people in this room get unbelievable amount of help that we're not even aware of. I'm not even talking about the accountants and the lawyers and the drivers and the gardeners, but automatic deposits, all kinds of things, healthcare. And you know, I signed a mortgage agreement. I couldn't understand a word I was reading. But I could trust somebody as opposed to somebody who sells me a ballooning version. So all this is kind of on its head. And why are we talking about all this? We're talking about all this because when you do anything, certainly public health, but a lot of other things too, that require people's behavior, you have to understand how people are behaving. This is a beautiful 100-year-old quote from an economist, but he basically says, look, you have to assume some psychology. Either you get roughly a good description of what people are doing, or you're going to make it up and you're going to do it badly. Now, I have a lot of examples of bad psychology, many examples. I just chose one that I think will be closer to your hearts before I end. So this is a story about the homeless in emergency rooms in Ontario. Big problem. There are a lot of homeless people coming to the emergency rooms in Ontario, and we don't want them all there. What do we do? The standard assumption for a long time was, look, Ontario is cold. Emergency rooms give you a cup of tea or water. We have to stop this to be less nice. Don Redlmeyer, a dear friend and a wonderful physician, and others had the suspicion this might not be quite right. So they ran a randomized trial where when the homeless came, half of them were assigned to the standard treatment. The other half got compassionate treatment. They have somebody who is attached to them, asks them repeatedly what's wrong, what they can do for them, make them feel super warm and fuzzy. And when they follow up some time later on this is all in the Lancet, you can read it, what they discover is that those who got the compassionate treatment are significantly less likely to return to this or any other emergency room in the county, in the province. And the point here, it turns out, that the homeless come not with life-threatening, but with real ailments. If they feel that people don't take them seriously, they come again, there or to another hospital. If they feel you did the best you could for them, they have absolutely no interest in coming back to the emergency room. And what you discover is that all these years, these well-intentioned doctors just had it upside down. Just misread the motivation and what caused the behavior that they were observing. And so to conclude, this is also how we finish the book. You know, life is a complicated cockpit. And what we've learned at this point is that you cannot make pilots any more successful. You have to design cockpits that are more conducive to good flight. I like this metaphor also because it doesn't take away the personal responsibility, which is so important to, you know, in American policymaking. A pilot who's not taking responsibility will never succeed. It's the good pilots who can take advantage of a successful cockpit as opposed to a cockpit that leads to errors. And there are unbelievable stories about badly designed cockpits, that some of which we review in the book. And so the way to think about it is really, you want to have people with some, you know, with the right values and right intentions, but then you have to design a world that makes all this easier and more conducive. I'll stop here and then we can talk. Thank you. So I think we're good with some questions. Yes.
One of the ways that I've heard people frame why poor people behave poorly. Schlaf from Tufts. One of the reasons that I've heard that sort of a blaming the victim approach is to talk about this notion that poor people, quote, discount the future. And I guess I would ask you, I think you've partly answered this question, but would you put that kind of thinking in the same bucket that it's really context, not character, that defines whether people behave with short-term interest versus long-term?
Yeah, good. So the study that I went quickly over with the Princeton students at least showed that if you take the person and do nothing else and put them in context where it's burning and urgent, they start looking like they're discounting the future. So that part we know. A lot of what we see in this case, in these studies, is that when you focus heavily on one thing, you just don't pay attention to other things. And that's going to look like discounting the future. So it's kind of interesting. A lot of the work on discounting, here's a thought experiment. I decide that I don't want to eat bread for a while. I want to diet. No more bread for me. We go to dinner. We sit down. The waiter comes and puts a nice basket of bread. We're talking. 2 minutes later, the basket is empty. Do you know that I'm discounting the future, or did I just never notice there was bread on the table? Extremely different interpretations of the same behavior. In one case, I said, oh my God, bread, I don't want to eat it, I can't resist, and I grab it. In the other case, I don't even know that it was there. So these are very subtle issues. When you look at the behavior of the poor, apart, by the way, from the normative defense that my life is shorter and less fun and I should enjoy it when I can, I'm not even going there. But cognitively speaking, it's often very hard to know. When I'm focusing heavily, like those Princeton did, and I do something silly, either I looked and I knew it's silly and I couldn't resist, or I didn't really look at it. And so those are very different nuances. Having said all that, look, my job here is to tell you how impactful context is. I'm not going to say that the poor don't have bad values or bad judgments. All the rich have terrible bad judgments too, by the way. It's just you don't catch them so quickly. But, you know, so the whole thing, you know, when I forget to pay the parking meter, I look like an idiot. But who cares? When I do the same thing and it's my kid's lunch for tomorrow, I look like a real idiot. But of course, it's neither one of us has had. Anyway, so there's no doubt. Look, there's a lot of work on culture, a lot of work on transmission, a lot of work on doing what your parents did. There's many reasons to think the poor are making some bad decisions. A lot of reasons to think the billionaires are making some terrible decisions. But apart from all that, what I am convinced of is, you put all that aside, there's a lot of evidence that if you're smart and thoughtful and patient, you're going to look bad in contexts that make you look bad.
Yes. So my name's Charlie Homer. I worked at HHS overseeing human services policy for the last few years. So based on this, what suggestions do you have for how we should be running our earned income tax credit programs or TANF or childcare, or you name the variety of programs? How, because when people would often mention behavioral economics, but they were doing very small changes, like the letter, you know, the wording in the letter, and which I was not terribly impressed.
We had a conversation about this earlier. Yes, so one of the success stories of behavioral economics in recent years has been Nudge. It's a very successful book and some beautiful insight. And I was saying earlier, I worry a bit that behavioral economics has become synonymous with nudging, because nudging is what you're describing, the small tweaks. Behavioral economics would be a lot more than that. I mean, the EITC, I'm not an expert, but the EITC is a good example. EITC, in some sense, when David Elwood and his gang with Clinton introduced it, it was a brilliant move. It was a brilliant move because it's earned. Instead of giving it to you, you have to earn it. And it turns out that both the rest of America and the recipients felt really good about earning their credit as opposed to being handed the credit. All the stigma changed, everything was altered. So it's a beautiful example that you're proposing of a behavioral manipulation that took some insight to see the big problem here is that people resent giving for nothing, but earning for something is fine. It's largely in the frame. Financially, it wasn't a big difference, but it was a big difference that way. It, by the way, produces now a big problem because we have some insight about how to do this with the working poor. We don't know how to do it with the non-working poor, which between disability and other reasons are not a small number. So this is, and disability might be able to be framed, other things less, but I think that's a beautiful question. I mean, look, the problem about behavioral research is that every case you're going to have to understand what the obstacles are, what the nuances are. There's no simple answer. But there's a way of thinking that's very different, which is I see people not doing something, not working, not taking a FAFSA. What do I learn from it? Not obvious. Either they don't want it or they would jump at it if I changed it, tweaked something. There's another interesting insight that I should mention. It's about evaluation, apropos HHS. So the bandwidth I'm talking about, the limited bandwidth you have, is the one you use to do your finances, to remember to take your medications on time, help your kids with your homework and exercise. It's all the same one. Now, imagine that I have a complicated life and you come and introduce some good banking instrument that makes my deposits and withdrawals easier. What we typically do is Treasury introduces some banking instrument and comes 2 years later and evaluates how people are doing on their banking. This story says something a little bit different. I have a single bandwidth I'm focusing on banking, children, health, nutrition, and now you come and you make my banking easier. One very reasonable thing for me to say is thank you so much. Now I can devote less bandwidth to my banking and more to my kids' homework. And what that means is when Treasury made my banking easier, you need to go and check my kids' school performance, which is not something we often do. So where you look to evaluate, once you look at this very limited organism who's trying to do a lot, it's precisely where you made their life easier that they might start doing less for all the right reasons and spend more energy and cognitive resources on the thing they've been neglecting. So that, I think it changes a bit how we might want to think about intervention and evaluation. Yeah.
Thank you. Great talk. My name is Susan Garfield. I'm interested in the implications of what you were talking about on gender in the workplace. So if you take the assumption of if you want to get something done, ask someone busy to do it, that often people who are multitasking are more effective at allocating time and mental bandwidth to get things done. And so when I think about the scarcity framework, it's fascinating, but it also worries me a little bit from a working mom standpoint that it could be kind of flipped on its side and said, well, maybe folks who are juggling too much might not be able to perform as highly when, you know, our experience may be just the opposite. So I was wondering about your thoughts on that and how we could use your research to understand that.
I think I understand where you're coming from, and I share one concern and I don't agree with the other. So I don't know what data you've seen that people who juggle more do it better. I understand the aphorism, but I'm skeptical. You know, when I go into class, you may remember this, my first day in my class, when I have 150 students with computers in front of them, I say to them, look, I know some of you are watching ice hockey or buying shoes on Amazon, and I assure you from everything I know, either you won't know what I said or you'll buy the wrong shoes. That's it. There is no other way. So I don't believe, I understand, look, of course, to some extent, up to a point, a person who's busy, that's a signal for endeavoring, for motivated, for able. So, of course, to some extent, if you want something done, you look for somebody who's functioning well as opposed to somebody who's sleeping, I understand. But the idea that at the end of the day, imposing more on somebody who's juggling, I'm not sure about. Having said that, I totally share your concern. So I haven't thought about the second shift about working mothers, although I think it's a good one. But here's my main concern. If you believe what I say, and you run a local McDonald's in Commonwealth, you say the next person I hire, I don't want to hire a poor person. He'll make more mistakes on the job. And I think you'll be right. And that really concerns me. And that was an implication. We're doing research. I'm not doing politics here. But in the book, although we don't talk about it much, the implication is that all else equal, people are juggling will make more mistakes and orders in Burger King. Of course, if you made their life easier, they won't. But until then, I totally agree. And the implication that that an image might suffer as a result, I'm totally with you. Yes.
Hi, Norbert Wilson. How long lasting are these effects? So the sugarcane example is a one-time shot. They receive this income. But the New Jersey example, the mall example, you perturb people with the heavy car payment they have to do. What happens over time? I mean, how long does that effect last?
So two things. There's different ways of interpreting this. Even with the India farmers example, there's some work recently done locally. juggling can get worse and worse as you become poorer to poorer. So in other words, 5 days before harvest, you might look worse than a month before. We have no data, but that's consistent with other things. The other kind of time effect, of course, is after years of poverty, and it's a whole different story about brain development that I don't know anything about. We've really done at the moment, as you say. If what you mean is how long does the concern last once I trigger it? So if I go to the subject in New Jersey and ask the question, do I come again tomorrow? It's a super interesting question. I do not know. I think, but that's going to depend on many things. It's going to depend on what interferes in between. It's going to interact with how big a concern it is. It's going to interact with what reminds you in the meantime. So if you're worried about poverty and I trigger it, and then many things you do the rest of the day have to do with money, it might be alive a lot longer than if something distracts you completely. It's a super interesting area. I don't know how to research well. You know where it becomes very relevant? If you look, we had a couple of discussions about fear of immigration. So fear is a very powerful emotion. When you scare people about Mexicans, they had no problem with Mexicans until they woke up that morning, now you scare them. That's a very powerful emotion. Another question, the really interesting question is, do you go and try to erase it, or do you just scare them with something new? See, my proposal is scare them about some major flood that's coming. Forget, you can't tell the Mexicans, just tell them the flood is coming tomorrow and save the Mexicans that way. Because the fear is so powerful that sometimes erasing it is harder than introducing a new one. And that's a little bit related to your question. If I'm struggling with scarcity, with money, what reminds me and what distracts me? You know, once my kid is sick, I might not think about money for, you know, it depends. We did some research, by the way, on the poor who get messages from a doctor. This is in a paragraph. The doctor basically gives you bad news, but the good news is that you'll heal eventually, et cetera, et cetera. And then ask them what comes to mind. We give them all kinds of words. The rich and the poor both have a lot of emotional words that come up when they describe the sentiments when they read the paragraph. But only the poor, not the rich, think about money. So when the doctor is talking to me, and by the way, we did this, and I don't want to put too much weight on it, it could be lucky. But when we replicated this in England, we lost the effect. You know, in England, you don't have to worry about money. They'll take care of it. But here, what we got is very clearly is that the poor introduce a lot more financial concerns as the doctor is talking to you, as opposed to when you're rich and she's telling you what you have. And that's a little bit, anyway. Yes.
First of all, thank you. That was very interesting. So assuming that these data are right, this flies in the face of what at least 50% of the country believes. I would argue it's probably 75%, but I'm just going by 50% since that half of the country keeps voting for a party that clearly does not agree with these data. So
yeah.
So it's less than 50%. So what's the next step? How do you change the narrative?
So I discovered from you an hour ago that this is the narrative month.
It is.
And I've been obsessed with narrative change. That's why I put this. And I didn't know that I was arriving at your narrative month, but there you go. I think it's a super interesting question. So look, what's the point here? My interpretation of this story is the following. A lot of behavioral research suggests that when you see somebody behave badly, you tend to think it's them. So if you see me beat my kid, I'm a bad parent. If you do it, it's because, you know, you hadn't slept well last night and there's a big thing that worries you and you lost your patience for a moment. A lot of behavioral research suggesting this. To the extent that you buy the idea that context has an enormous effect on how people behave, and people tend to interpret it looking at the person and not in the context, it's going to be an enormous amount of built-in systematic misunderstanding of what causes behaviors. So when you see the poor farmers, when you see the poor taking payday loans, if you interpret it as the person's disposition, you miss the whole story because all the data suggests, no, it's the context that made them do it. Now, why is this relevant? Because if you look at the US today, I propose some of these. If you haven't read Bryan Stevenson, by the way, I don't even know if to tell you to read it or not to read it, but in any case, it's hard to sleep. We're in a country today where you have a profound, I'm going to ignore for a moment those who are not this way, but I really do think the majority of people are well-intentioned Christian Americans who want to do good. And we have insanely angry, draconian, unforgiving laws. Of course, that impact mostly minorities and the poor, but in general. And the question is, why would good people do this? And I think it's partly that. I think it's partly looking and not understanding what you're seeing, thinking it's people with the wrong values, with the wrong intentions, who don't care enough, as opposed to, you know, they're just as good as you, but context is complicated. So I was describing to some of you, we in some travel we did in Ferguson, we talked to a wonderful 20-year-old mother who leaves her two kids home alone and runs to work so she doesn't lose her job, only to come back and get arrested for endangering her children. Now, you can argue about whether it's good to leave your kids alone, but giving this woman a jail record and inability to get work for doing this clearly requires a certain set of assumptions that are just not right. So the judge clearly didn't think that she loved her kids as much as his mother loved him. He thought something else. And the question is, how do you change that narrative? So that's kind of the interesting story. Matt Desmond's book on evictions is mind-boggling. So these are all cases where basically you look at somebody, the world of eviction, I mean, these tenants look terrible. You've been evicted once. The only thing you can do now is live in a place that's worse than where you were before. And you're paying as much as living in Beverly Hills. And you can't afford it, so you have more people in the house so you can afford it. Then you have more people in the house than is allowed by the landlord, which means you can't let anybody in because then they'll see there's too many people. So now the toilet breaks, and you can't let anybody in. So you spend 10 years without a functioning toilet. And guess what? You're going to look less good in the morning when you go to work. And that's how it goes. And so the question here, it's a long way of answering it, is there a way to change the narrative that comes to the average American's mind when they look at the poor? The LGBT has a pretty remarkable success story. 30 years at a group by the name of GLAAD has been devoting to changing the image of the LGBT community. And it's amazing. I mean, they took a group that looked sick and scary and turned them into magnificent people. So we've turned, you know, the gay community from disgusting to cool. We've taken smokers and turned them from cool to disgusting. And the question is, what can we do with poverty? And, you know, I'm trying to talk to people and think about it. I think it's a complicated issue. And the additional issue that has arisen now, in addition to what you do, is how do you transmit it? When GLAAD did this for the LGBT, they went to Hollywood and the press. That was at a time when everybody read the New York Times or another paper, and everybody watched the Cosby Show. Now, you have to have directed marketing, you have to have Facebook, you know, echo chambers, you have to find a way to get to people that are much more complicated. But I think there are people who know more about it, and hopefully they can help. Yeah.
Please join me in thanking Dr. Shafir.
Thank you.